NTV Television Network presents. The Other Day, Current Era, 1999, translation and voiceover by BMI Russian. Good evening and welcome to episode 39 of The Other Day, Current Era, modern day events for the history books. Today we're covering 1999, the fuel crisis, Skuratov, forest fires, the Barber of Siberia, Kafelnikov is number one, the war in Yugoslavia, the solar eclipse, the Bank of New York scandal, the second Chechen war, the book Generation P, and the song They Killed the Negro. After 10 years of foreign TV series dominating in Russia, domestic television struck back with a vengeance. Streets of Broken Lights were achieving record-breaking ratings. The characters from Andrei Kivinov's book series were known all around the country, with people simply referring to them as cops.
There he is.
Okay, what else did he take?
A golden necklace.
Okay, this will keep you warm. Go to the precinct. I'll handle this. You'll find a handkerchief in the coat pocket. Wipe your tears. Hey! Cease and desist!
The dirty streets of St. P, street slang, no star actors, there's the formula for success produced by TNT. The five cops working in the homicide unit were the heartthrob Kazantsev, the sad wisecrack Larin, the gentle giant Dukalis, the brains behind the Operation Solovets, and rookie detective Volkov. The MVD awarded the actors for creating a positive image for law enforcement.
Do you understand? He's grieving!
I see you want to go to jail. Give me the necklace.
The contemporary protagonist was capable of threatening, screaming, or even getting violent. But in every episode, he did his due diligence in looking for criminals. In 1999, two Arab rulers passed away who had been in power for decades. Hussein of Jordan had been king since 1953, Hassan of Morocco since 1961. The Moroccan monarch was little known beyond the Arab world. In Russia, his passing went largely unnoticed. But Hussein, together with the US, was a guarantor of peace between Israel and Palestine, which in itself made him an international player. According to his official biography, Hussein was a direct descendant of Muhammad in the 39th generation. Primakov was supposed to visit on behalf of Russia, him being a trained Arabist and a good friend of the deceased. But then at the last moment, Yeltsin, who was speculated to be in very bad health, decided to go himself. Primakov's trip cancelled in such haste, as well as the Russian president's six-hour visit to the capital of Jordan, proved to be an even bigger sensation than the US president winding up in the same place as Libyan leader Gaddafi for the first time ever. Yeltsin had clearly seen better days, but he pulled himself together to show his country and the world that he should still be taken seriously.
Forrest Gump.
Starring Tom Hanks. Congratulations, how do you feel?
I gotta pee.
I believe he said he has to go pee.
A dream came true for tennis fans and for those who were just proud of anything our country achieved in general. The world's best tennis player was Russian. In 1999, 25-year-old Sochi native Yevgeny Kafelnikov was in the number one spot for a total of 6 weeks. Though the way in which the historic result was achieved was sort of a letdown. They had a very convoluted method for calculating ratings in tennis. And prior to becoming number one, Kafelnikov was losing in the very first round for 6 tournaments in a row. His main rival, Pete Sampras from the US, was out of the game due to injury. Kafelnikov completed the season as number 2 in the world rankings. The following year, they implemented a revised scoring method. Pete, thank you for giving me the opportunity to win and to claim this wonderful trophy. In February of 1999, Abdullah Öcalan, the Turkish state's enemy number one and the leader of the Kurdish rebellion, was detained after wandering the world. With the relationship improving between Ankara and Damask, Öcalan was forced to flee from his longtime haven, Syria. He came to Russia, that didn't sit well with the Russian government, and so he went to Europe, where he was ambushed in Rome's airport with the help of Greek authorities. Then he moved to Kenya, was apprehended by Turkish security services in Nairobi, and flown back to Turkey. The Kurds, most of which lived in Turkey, were a population of 20 million people who didn't have their own country. Founder of the Kurdistan Workers' Party Öcalan had been instigating armed conflict since 1984, terrorist acts and actual warfare on the Turkish-Iraqi border. The Kurds in various parts of the world responded to their leader's arrest by setting themselves on fire, with bombings and by storming embassies, especially in those countries that refused to provide refuge to Öcalan. The human torches who sacrificed themselves in the center of Moscow, and a series of terrorist acts in Turkey seriously terrified Russian tourists who were looking to visit Antalya. Öcalan was imprisoned on the deserted Imrali Island in the Sea of Marmara. Unsurprisingly, he was sentenced to death, but authorities didn't dare to execute him. At last, the former most reading nation produced a true book of the year, one that all of the savvy folks were discussing, and that everyone else was obliged to read to get their own idea. It wasn't offering any sort of grand philosophy. It wasn't supposed to call, lead, or do any sort of deep digging. This was Viktor Pelevin's Generation P, a portrayal of the times that were overrun by ads, image-making, and people exclaiming, wow. You know a book is trendy when people repeat its quips. Coca calling bell, Pepsi calling bell, the Church of the Savior on Provim, a respectable god for a respectable gentleman, etc. The most renowned author of the time, Pelevin, was notorious for refusing interviews and even hiding his own face. His book described the career of an advertising copywriter, and it was a hit with mid-level managers and Russian internet users. The contemporary Russian Literature Society was quite limited. All in all, a mere 170,000 copies of the book were printed. The entire book-reading crowd had to make do with a run of less than the 200,000 usually printed by Soviet author publishing house. On March 24th, the United States led NATO forces in an effort against the regime of Yugoslavian President Milosevic. Russia's rhetoric was ignored entirely. All of the promises to support and stand up for our Yugoslavian brethren in a difficult time. NATO, that is the US, acted with total disregard for the international community. The more astute observers warned that given the chance, they'd send troops to Russia as well. With the country humiliated once again, anti-American attitudes were on the rise. And after the war was over and they'd initiated a peacekeeping effort, Russia was finally able to show those Westerners, well, at least in some people's minds. The literal representation of Russia's foreign policy shift was Prime Minister Primakov. He was en route to the US on the 23rd of March, but he turned his plane around in midair over the Atlantic. He had a phone conversation with American Vice President Al Gore, who couldn't promise that the war wouldn't begin during his visit. After the first few airstrikes, Milosevic severed relations with Western countries, while Russia put all contacts with NATO on pause. In Moscow, people were throwing eggs and cans of paint at the US embassy. Even when standing up for Vietnam and Angela Davis, we never went that far. Once again, we were using terms such as American militarism and American aggression. Then there were the wild suggestions such as uniting Yugoslavia with Belarus and Russia. As a result of 25,000 airstrikes, Yugoslavia's military infrastructure and most of its industry were decimated. Milosevic backed down and agreed to allow a peacekeeping contingent into Kosovo that would include Russian troops. Russian paratroopers promptly left their dislocation in Bosnia and Herzegovina, traveling 250 miles to occupy the number one strategic object in Pristina, which was the airfield. Such fist-waving after the fight left the West in utter awe, but Yeltsin appreciated such peacekeeping on our own terms, and so he decided to reward the unit. From the 45th Guards Spetsnaz Brigade, Yeltsin just couldn't find a good prosecutor general. Stepankov let him down during the events of 93, Kazannik was too quick to release the latter event's heroes from jail, Ilyushenko went to jail himself. For the entire year of 1999, Yeltsin, who according to the constitutional norm would propose for the Council of the Federation to then approve, wasn't quite able to send Yuri Skuratov into retirement. Yeltsin suggested firing the prosecutor general because the latter filed a request himself, but Skuratov insisted that he wrote the request against his own will, that he was being blackmailed by the Kremlin for possibly uncovering corruption in the upper echelons of power. As of recently, I personally and to some extent the prosecutor's office in general have been dealing with unfortunate circumstances that prevent us from doing our job. Skuratov received majority support from the Council of the Federation. Yeltsin's proposal was overruled. That same evening, Russian television aired the tapes that they were using to blackmail Skuratov. A real pain in the neck. Nah, it's not a secret. My name is Yuri. Art professor Shvidkoy, who was the head of Russian television, coined the popular phrase, "a man who looks like the prosecutor general." The man you see on those tapes, he's not familiar with the two women that he's with. They get acquainted in the process of whatever they're doing. Yeltsin made two more attempts to unseat Skuratov, but both times he was thwarted by the Senate. The president fired him and appointed a temporary replacement. Skuratov filed a blackmail report. The prosecutor's office charged him with abuse of power. Skuratov in turn claimed that it was illegal to press such charges. And the story just went on and on, with the criminal investigation I'm currently conducting. The entire world has seen this footage, and such behavior on behalf of Monica during the post-election celebration is seen as circumstantial evidence of... For the first time ever, a movie praising the great triad, orthodoxy, autocracy, and nationality, was shot on American Kodak film. The entire country in 1999 was going to see a movie by Nikita Mikhalkov under the tagline "He's Russian, that explains a lot," titled "The Barber of Siberia." Just like every other ideological endeavor, this movie was more than just a movie in Russia. Mikhalkov himself insisted that it represented the Russian dream. This was essentially a three-hour advert for Alexander III's Russia made on a Hollywood budget, with Mikhalkov himself in the key role as the Tsar. Greetings, cadets! You've put on a bit of weight, General. But Your Majesty, this was a side of Russia never seen by its contemporary Mikhail Saltykov Shchedrin. No wonder it left Julia Ormond's character clueless. Her only excuse was that she returned to the States bearing a child from Oleg Menshikov's character. Being born and raised in the US, her son, also played by Menshikov, he understood the whole thing. It was the American sergeant, amazed by his character, who drew the main conclusion. He's a Russian, that explains a lot. More. On February 10, 1999, 57 law enforcement officers were burned alive in Samara Province police headquarters. Over 200 people sustained injuries and severe burns. There could have been fewer casualties, but leave it to the police chiefs to ignore warnings from their own subordinates about their building being a fire hazard. At first, they tried to put the fire out themselves. When they finally did call the fire department, it was too late. Firefighters arrived to see three floors up in flames. Water pressure in the building was too low, it had no fire baffles, but it did have exterior heat insulation, which made it so hot inside that human bones would burn without even leaving a trace. The synthetic interior trim produced poisonous smoke, which took more policemen lives than the fire did. You're getting in the way, step aside. Please get off the driveway. Fire! The local population was crying arson. The fire destroyed papers pertaining to Operation Cyclone targeting the Avtovaz Mafia, and it also killed almost the entire economic crime unit. But the prosecutor's office concluded that the fire was caused by a cigarette butt. A series of horrendous earthquakes hits popular resorts in Turkey, Taiwan, and Greece right in the middle of tourist season. Turkey was struck by one of the most severe quakes of the 20th century. Over 20,000 people had fallen victim to a 7.5 magnitude earthquake. The city of Izmit was decimated, the hot weather meant high risk for spreading disease, and so Turkish authorities decided to conduct a mass burial without identifying the bodies. The Taiwan quake at a magnitude of 7.8 was even harsher, with the Nantou resort caught in the epicenter. However, it didn't claim nearly as many victims, only about 3,000. Foreign rescuers were saying that they'd never seen such earthquake-resistant housing, though high-rise office buildings in Taipei did collapse. 50 people were killed by the earthquake in Athens. Hundreds of buildings were damaged, but the ancient Greek architecture on the Acropolis survived. Some disaster diplomacy. Turkey and Greece were at odds, but they both immediately offered each other assistance and gratefully accepted. Russia arranges a massive celebration to honor Pushkin's 200th birthday. The anniversary was actively promoted, giving you the impression that Pushkin was running for president. Meanwhile, the actual president declared the classic poet's birthday a national holiday. They started a countdown days in advance, and there was a popular joke that went, "There's only 5 rubles left until Alexander Pushkin's birthday." In 1999, Pushkin was more of a national treasure than ever. With a commemorative poster, monument, fountain, medal, multiathlon event, ship, song, ballet, chocolates, and vodka. One satirist with a conscience exclaimed, "Mr. Pushkin, we regret that it has come down to this. There weren't a lot of figures for people to look up to, and here comes a universally acclaimed genius who you could never praise too much." Most of the money was spent on restoring and repairing iconic locations, with the Mikhailovskaya Museum even being rebuilt from the ground up. During his life, Pushkin never even had his own home, but now he appeared to be a super-rich museum landlord. Our beloved poet is still alive. He's 37 years old. When he left, here's where he horsed around, flirted with girls. Oleg Romantsev, who became the national soccer team's head coach in 1999, let most of the foreign players go, while laying his own club Spartak as the team's foundation, and starting on the path towards the European Championship from square one. By that time, the team had already lost 3 qualification games in a row. Under the new head coach, our team defeated Armenia and then Andorra. The match with France was the decider, where if we won, we'd at least have a chance. The French team had previously won the World Championship where Russia wasn't even allowed to participate. France beat Brazil then in the finals. How could we ever win? But on July 5th, a miracle happened in Paris. The Russian team won, scoring 3-2 against France. The hero of the day? Zenit St. Petersburg forward Alexander Panov, who scored 2 points. Given a lack of any other options, all of a sudden soccer becomes the Russian dream. We defeated the world champions on their own turf, right here, at the Stade de France, a state-of-the-art stadium where the French had never lost to anyone. After years of humiliation, here was something to feed our national pride. Right here, we proved to ourselves and to everyone else that we're worth something, that not all is lost and we can still make things happen. Look, we're okay at soccer. Perhaps there are more achievements to come. And the national team continued to deliver, winning game after game. Panov became a national hero, with the media touting him as a European superstar. The day after the match was July 6th, which was Pushkin's 200th birthday. And one newspaper came out with a vindictively patriotic headline: To Dante's Motherland from the Descendants of Pushkin. Russia couldn't afford to lose the final home game with the Ukraine, while they could make do with the time. 2 days prior to the match, Luzhniki Stadium was sold out. Fans from both sides were hysterical and aggressive, and it felt as if the results would bring closure to the historical rivalry between two schools of soccer, two nations and peoples. The Russian team brought its A game, scoring the first goal on minute 75. The Russian team didn't score any more points. Then, 2 minutes before the end, goalkeeper Filimonov made a comical screw-up. Shevchenko took a shot, and the Russian goalie dropped the ball into his own box. It was a tie, which for Russia was equivalent to defeat and failure to qualify for the European Championship. In 1999, after a lengthy pause, oil prices were once again on the rise. In Russia, this sparked a fuel crisis. Prices grew by 20%, supply couldn't keep up with demand. I heard on the radio that there's only 8 days' worth of gasoline left. Gasoline was flowing away from low domestic prices towards high prices in neighboring countries. It cost twice as much in China and Japan and four times more in the Ukraine and Poland. Fuel was even being exported by agricultural firms that were able to buy it at a discount. In order to reverse the petroleum product flow, the government banned all export of gasoline. By autumn, the cost of 92 and 95 octane gasoline was no longer growing. The Mir space station's last crew left for Earth. Upon leaving, they turn off the lights and the oxygen generator. This inhabitable island in space was now deserted, and by March of 2000, it was due to fall into the ocean. The only thing keeping Mir in orbit all these years were commercial space projects. But foreigners were no longer keen to make trips to the Russian station, and the country simply didn't have the $200 million required to keep it running. Energia Corporation got so desperate that it even ran a newspaper ad asking wealthy and average citizens alike for financial support. To the experts, this was an absolute disgrace. They were upset that 11 tons of equipment went to waste, and that Russia wouldn't be flying into space for at least 5 years. The West was concerned that during descent, the station might become uncontrollable. Fashion designer Paco Rabanne even speculated that Mir would fall onto Paris right on the day of the eclipse, on August 11th.
Today, the last fruit fly perished.
...1999 was the second year in a row when Russia had three prime ministers. In May, the president fired Primakov, replacing him with Stepashin, who in August was replaced by Putin. Primakov was unable or unwilling to talk the left wing of the Duma out of impeaching Yeltsin. The latter sent him into retirement 1 day before the vote, in so signaling that he was ready for anything. The Duma was flustered. Even the most severe charge pertaining to the war in Chechnya didn't receive the required number of votes. Commenting on Stepashin's appointment, Duma Speaker Selezniov said that there had been a different candidate planned. My ears are clean. The telephone was working just fine, and I do recall the president naming Aksyonenko. First Deputy Prime Minister Aksyonenko would continue to be mentioned all throughout Stepashin's very brief term, even on the morning he retired.
Good day.
I think I'll stand, unless I wear out my welcome, right? Putin was the third former intelligence officer to become prime minister. The constant shuffling had undermined the importance of the position, and to drive home the point that this one was here to stay, Yeltsin referred to him as his successor, claiming that he'd like to see Putin become president in 2000.
The Russian people, they, will have the opportunity to assess the professional and personal qualities of Mr. Putin.
In 1999, Europe was plagued by a series of produce catastrophes. Shocking news came in from the prosperous Belgium. First, they found 140 times the normal quantity of carcinogenic dioxin in local poultry. And after that, Belgian schoolgirls suffered mass Coca-Cola poisoning. That prompted Europe to wage a full-on war against the American soft drink. The dioxin had contaminated the flour that Belgian farmers were using to feed their chickens. Chicken meat and eggs were now undergoing more thorough inspection. However, the highly toxic chemical had already scared away other Euro Union countries, who also decided to rehabilitate British beef in the wake of the scandal. Several hundred people got poisoned by Coca-Cola first in Belgium and then in France. Both countries immediately banned its sale, followed soon after by Spain, the Netherlands, and Luxembourg. In Portugal, they found and seized a shipment of Coca-Cola containing charcoal sediment. For the first time in its 113-year history, the company had to apologize to the buyers. The packaging was contaminated due to improper carbonation. Coca-Cola's main rival Pepsi was gleeful. European offices couldn't process orders fast enough. The summer of 1999 was hot. Forest fires began spreading as early as in March, and by July-August, the situation had escalated into a national emergency. That year, there was a total of 31,000 forest fires, which almost broke the record of 1972. The fires engulfed almost every region. Siberia, the Ural Mountains, both capital provinces, and the entire Russian north. Given the scale of these fires, with almost 10,000 acres of land burning, we just weren't prepared for this. We are not sufficiently equipped. Smoke from smoldering moors even reached the outskirts of Moscow. President Yeltsin even had to leave his residence in Zavidovo due to all of the smoke. In Russia, it was always the norm for the ruler's entourage to have a say in important decisions. In Russia, power had often been equivalent to property. And in 1999, the two were no longer separate. In keeping with the classic formula, family origins, private property, and the state were one and the same in Russia. Prior to 1999, media allegations of corruption would target the prime minister tops, but the president was like the Queen of England, above any suspicion. 1999 almost completely destroyed his reputation of a man concerned only with the good of his country and his own role in history. Of course, the allegations could have been made up, and the same can be said about the image of the president. He actually employed his own daughter as an image advisor, who the government's critics were calling the head of the clan. At first, it seemed as if Yeltsin's surgery transformed him from an unhealthy and overweight Soviet grandpa into an energetic and lean American elder. But it wasn't long before he returned to his old form and even got worse. In 1999, his face was getting more swollen by the month, he needed glasses to read his speeches, and he was barely able to turn the pages despite them being laminated.
Is that it?
Despite some people claiming that Yeltsin only listened to advice corresponding with his own perspective, he seemed to be easily manipulated. Wicked tongues were naming his entire unofficial entourage, all the people calling the shots. His daughter and advisor Tatiana Diachenko, former head of the presidential administration Yumashev, current head Voloshin. Then there were two shadow figures, the owner of Sibneft Roman Abramovich and the chairman of Moscow Business World Bank Alexander Mamut. In August, first the Italian and then the entire global media began speculating about the net worth of Yeltsin's family clan. Something about the president and his daughters opening accounts in Santander Bank, someone depositing $1 million to Budapest Bank, and credit cards being either issued or them backed by guarantees. Presidential property manager Borodin's accounts were covered in even more detail, with him even suing the Spanish newspaper Corriere della Sera. The Kremlin's big boss kept silent, deeming it unbefitting of His Highness to argue with reporters, and ignoring headlines like instead of the nation's father, he became the godfather. On August 11, 1999, 1.5 billion Earthlings witnessed a solar eclipse. The sun turned into a crescent and proceeded to roll over densely populated areas of the world. India, Iran, the Balkans, Western Europe. People were waiting for the moon to block the sun at the 20th century's end like it was some big show. For the first time ever, people were running towards the eclipse, not away from it. Southern European hotels were overrun with moon shadow hunters. While the sun was still shining, millions of special glasses and eclipse witness certificates were being sold. The Romanian town of Râmnica Vâlcea was declared the eclipse capital. Here, the night in broad daylight lasted for 2 minutes and 23 seconds. For $2,000, you could buy an extension ticket onto a Concorde supersonic plane to chase the eclipse for a good 8 minutes. Meanwhile, in the former Soviet Union, the place where the moon covered the most amount of sun, at 93%, was Izmail in Odessa province. Moscow was experiencing cloudy weather on August 11th, so nobody saw the sun at all, let alone the 58% eclipse. Going on their first vacations after the crisis, many had to settle for cheap Russian resorts. For the first time in the 90s, Russia was in the top 3 most popular tourist destinations. Though our service left a lot to be desired. Russian resorts were at an advantage that summer. On top of the ruble devaluation, there was the Balkan War, the earthquake and the civil unrest in Turkey, and the earthquake in Greece. A 2-week vacation in Sochi or the Crimea, which nobody considered a foreign destination, cost about $300 to $400, undercutting all of the competition. But some of the patrons had already been places and forgotten what it's like when the hot water is out. The old hotels and recreation centers were 1 to 2 stars at best, water shortages were still a thing, not to mention that catering and personnel hadn't evolved at all since Soviet times. On September 20th, 1999, Raisa Gorbacheva died of blood cancer in Münster. The whole country felt sorry for their family during the 2 months her husband was witnessing her fade away in a German clinic. The ex-presidential couple probably wasn't even hoping to live to see the people's attitudes towards them change so radically. I used to purchase things that I was supposed to wear as the wife of the president. But in my everyday life, they were absolutely useless. I was spending my own money on them, my own hard-earned money. They weren't just handed to me. While Gorbachev was in power, she was called Raika in private conversations. People were annoyed that she followed him on trips, was condescending, never minded her own business, but now she was being praised for the same thing, for showing the world what a modern Russian woman was like, refusing to be overshadowed by her husband all while maintaining a healthy family. Everybody was feeling for Mr. Gorbachev. He wasn't the first Russian ruler who put his wife above power. Losing Raisa was much more painful than having to resign as president. Post-crisis trade was all about pleasing people and bettering their lives. 1999 saw a rapid decrease in the price of ladas, which in the olden days used to be a status symbol, and of the main prestige item of those days, which were cell phones. Demand for Russia's finest automobiles after the crisis was so high that the Avtovaz plant had to work on weekends. They exceeded their plan by 25,000 cars. This led to an overproduction crisis, with Lada prices halved by the end of the year. The cost of a 2105 in the fall was $2,300, a 2109 $3,500. Mobile phones, which used to cost even more than a Lada, had become 100 times less expensive in 5 years. At first, cell phones were Mercedes S600 level unattainable. But after the crisis, sales dropped fourfold, prompting business to seek those customers who were willing to spend $50 on a phone. Cell phones were no longer a luxury. Vishnevsky's one-liner about forgetting his cell phone in the subway became a reality. Furby, a smart stuffed toy that looked like an owl with the internals of a mini-computer, was a big trend of 1999. It was the first ever electronic animal that would react with a satisfied purr when you'd pet or squeeze it. But Furby's main party trick was its ability to talk. Furbies were able to sing and dance, you could spoon-feed them, they'd laugh, move their ears, they'd go to sleep if the room got dark, and wake up if the lights came on. Furbies loved having their back petted or their belly tickled. Newborn Furbies spoke their own language and would come with a Furbish English dictionary. But you could also teach a Furby to talk like a human, and somewhat coherently repeat whatever you say to it. Fans of the new toy shared their training experience with one another. Lonely folks wouldn't part with their pets for even a minute. In the US, where people were particularly enamored with Furbies, they were officially banned from the Pentagon, as well as the CIA and FBI's facilities. In September of 1999, Russia was shaken by a series of horrific terrorist acts. For the first time in 20th century Russian history, that could only be labeled as ill-fated, one housing complex after another was being blown up in the night. The explosives were planted in such an amount as to guarantee as many casualties as possible. The first explosion happened on September 5th in a Russian military housing complex in Buynaksk, Dagestan. 62 people were killed. They found a truck nearby containing another 200 pounds of explosives and a timer set to 1:30 a.m. On the 9th, another explosion, this time in Moscow on Gorianova Street, where 92 people died. Then on Kashirskoye Highway on the 13th, with 118 dead. The terrorists rented the basements for storage and planted the explosives in such a way as to destroy the load-bearing elements. The bombings were also carried out at night, when everybody was home. You sleeping tight on the night before your death? Was the sinister question of the fall of 1999. This was the first time provincial Russia actually felt sorry for Moscow. Yes, you could earn easy money in Moscow, but when push comes to shove, Moscow will be the first to suffer. And the victims weren't even some nouveau riches either. They were very much regular citizens, no different from any other bedroom community dweller in Russia. Moscow got bombed because Moscow makes policy, while the North Caucasus got hit because Chechnya is their next-door neighbor. Surely the Russian heartland cities had nothing to fear. They were just thousands of obscure circles on the map, where nothing exciting ever happened. Living quietly, not looking for any trouble. On the night from the 15th to the 16th of September, an explosion occurred in Volgodonsk that killed 18 people. The explosives weren't inside the building, but rather in a truck parked next to it. It felt as if the horrific explosions would continue with no end. As usual, nobody claimed responsibility for the bombings, though the people were sure that it was the Chechens. Official investigation reports were pointing in the same direction. These are the people who might be responsible for the Volgodonsk bombing. Rumor had it that St. Petersburg could be the next target. There were real and fabricated reports about explosives being seized coming out of various Russian cities, and the destructive power of hexogen, a highly explosive sugar-like substance, was a popular talking point. There were neighborhood patrols all over Russia, with people checking basements and cellars together with militia. So for 4 days and four nights, we've had squads on watch duty.
While the hunters were loading their rifles,
in 1999, the second big Caucasian war in 20th century Russian history broke out. It was preceded by fighting in Dagestan, but the main battlefield, of course, was located in Chechnya. In early August, Chechen units led by Shamil Basayev and Khotab crossed the border of Dagestan. They occupied villages in two of its districts, where they intended to establish Islamic rule. After a six-week battle with Russia's regular army, the insurgents were forced back into Chechnya. And after all of the bombings, a sanitary cordon was put up around Chechnya in order to prevent further terrorist acts. Later on, there was a change in the objectives, and the army began to move deep into Chechnya. Authorities announced the first phase of an anti-terrorist operation, which involved seizing the northern territories and reaching the Terek. After that, the operation went into phase two. It followed the same basic tactic with air and artillery strikes coming first. Once again, there were Chechen units being assembled to serve Moscow. Yeltsin even released former Grozny mayor Gantemirov from a Russian prison so that he could lead them. By the end of the year, Chechnya's capital was blockaded, and most of the separatist combatants had fled into the mountains. And while Russian public opinion was mostly unanimous, the terrorists had to be crushed in their own nest. The West was just as apprehensive as during the first war. While conceding that terrorism is evil, they did not approve of Russia's methods.
You have absolutely no right to criticize Russia over Chechnya.
Prime Minister Vladimir Putin, who took it upon himself to oversee the operation, appeared to be the most powerful of the Siloviks, the long-awaited avenger and the country's most popular politician. We will hunt the terrorists down, be it at an airport. Or excuse me, but if we catch them in the toilet, we'll wipe them out in the outhouse. The skeptics were saying that they had no idea how the nation's future father would make peace, what to consider victory in Chechnya, or what fully solving the issue would look like. Small theaters in Moscow and St. Petersburg were showing a film called Khrustalev My Car by Alexei German. It took 8 years to complete and reach theaters due to organizational and financial woes. The movie was poorly received at the 99 Cannes Film Festival, while back home it was considered Russian cinema's greatest achievement of the 1990s.
If the engine runs, then I demand you take me to the poorhouse immediately.
So much for breakfast. The French media apologized for its previous criticism, Russian critics for the local public. The plot was pretty hard to follow. It was more of a guessing game. Even the director himself had no intention of sharing a story from an army doctor general's practice. Khrustalev My Car was a phrase famously uttered by Beria from the porch of Stalin's country home on March 5, 1953. As always, German was trying to portray an era. Crowded shots and deafening background noise were a consequence of complex settings and sound design, respectively. Somebody once used the words texture gone mad to describe German's films. Khrustalev My Car was a reminder of why cinema even existed.
It's too late to go to the bathroom, but we need to go!
In December of 1999, or the third time during Yeltsin's presidency, a state Duma election was held. Russian parliamentarianism didn't last long, which is probably why each election cycle brought something new with it. This time around, it was a triumph of electoral technologies. The campaign was anything but nuanced, with smear tactics being at the forefront. The reigning party and the opposing Fatherland All Russia movement were actively taking shots at one another. The fact that a pro-government bloc called Unity Bear was hastily formed was deemed by foreign inspectors to be outrageous executive meddling in the election. Then again, Russia was always putting the current political agenda above any sort of abstract ideals of democracy. Also, they finally held a televised debate. We need to ensure the country's prosperity. I know you have hard-working folks in your party. And though I might not agree with them on everything, but some of your people are competent. All I'm asking is you think it over. Maybe for once in your life you'll take responsibility and take action. Seriously, for once in your life. You know what their answer was? I'll give you three tries to guess.
Yeah.
The Communist Party, Zhirinovsky's LDPR and Yevlinsky's Yabloko pretty much broke even. The big change was in the reigning party. This was not a case of the winning party appointing the cabinet, but rather the appointed cabinet imposing its own faction onto the parliament. Aside from the nomenclature Unity Bear, there was another sort of reigning party, the young, radical, claiming itself to be neoliberal Union of Right Forces, spearheaded by Kirienko, Hakamada, and Nemtsov. The Russian government could finally put together a loyal majority in the parliament.
You will never forget Leonardo DiCaprio, Kate Winslet, in a James Cameron film, Titanic.
On August 19, 1999, the New York Times reported on over $10 billion being transferred through the Bank of New York by an obscure company called Benex. According to the FBI, the funds came from Russia and belonged to the Russian mafia. The money, which was half the annual budget of an entire country, was being sent to former Soviet citizen Semyon Mogilevich. This began the so-called Russo-Gate scandal that tarnished the reputation of Russia and its business world. As it turned out, the bank employees involved in the scandal were also Soviet immigrants. Two women were relieved of their duties. One was married to Russia's former IMF representative, the other to the owner of the aforementioned Benex. The media's main focus was now the treacherous Russians, who were begging for foreign loans, embezzling the money and laundering it in American banks. Official Moscow wasn't overly keen to react. Even when our generous creditor IMF had come to sue was forced to announce his resignation in the wake of the scandal, or when the Bank of New York announced that they had an account that might belong to Yeltsin's daughter's husband, Russian businessmen were basically equated to gypsies, or at least considered very shady. We're talking African levels of dubiousness, with Russia being compared to Nigeria in terms of its endless corruption. We're at the Bank of New York headquarters on the most famous street in the city of the same name. That's Broadway, this is Wall Street. Up there you can see their flag. There is no customer service happening here. Moreover, it's too crowded of a location in the center of the city to even apply the term banking confidentiality. But the district office in Upper East Side, that's a different story. The whole Bank of New York situation is what we used to call two worlds, two Shapiros, and later two worlds, two De Niros, in the sense that our financial organizations were also called banks. But to them, money was money, while American banks had an entire list consisting of 85 different kinds of money that they were not allowed to process, even if it meant losing a certain amount of profit. It wouldn't have been worth the reputational damage anyway, with the Bank of New York debacle being a case in point. And that brings us to two worlds, two bankers. Here's the form you need to fill out to open an account. Well, first off, it's a violation of Russian law for a Russian citizen to open a foreign bank account. Second of all, the employees at the bank will immediately notice your last name that ends with OV and that you're named like Brezhnev. You see, prior to the Bank of New York scandal, only Russians had disdain for Russian business, because it was business. But afterwards, Russian business was despised all over the world, on account of being Russian. Even though technically 2001 was the start of the 21st century and the third millennium, the numerological transition from 1999 to 2000 was still captivating. Among Christians, it was an even bigger occasion than Christmas. Throughout human history, such milestones were always expected to bring doomsday with them, and this time people were anticipating a virtual end of the world. Over the course of 50 years, computers had become ubiquitous, finding their place in homes and even in military nuclear technology. And now they had become a ticking time bomb. It turned out that when counting years, only the last two digits were considered by their programming, which would have resulted in most computers going to 1900 instead of 2000. This could have potentially disrupted dispatcher service and operation in the realm of transportation, banking, at military facilities. The world became aware of the Y2K bug 2 years prior to the date. As for Russia's New Year's preparations, they could have been going much better. The West was concerned about our military computers, and the US even sent experts over to help. Otherwise, the number set the tone for a wonderful holiday that didn't rule out celebrating the new millennium once again in 2001. On December 31st, 1999, just a few hours before the new year, Boris Yeltsin makes one final astonishing move as the president. He addressed the nation on TV at noon, announcing an early resignation and delegating his authority to Prime Minister Vladimir Putin. Despite there being some obvious benefits for Yeltsin in such a move, nobody thought he'd have the guts to go through with it. Yeltsin's appeal featured some amazing rhetoric. On his way out, Yeltsin apologized to the people and for the Russian dream that never came true. The common hope of quickly attaining good fortune.
I would like to apologize to you for the fact that many of our dreams never came true.
Yeltsin, one of the most arrogant Russian rulers ever, apparently was looking out for the common man. There was no need to build all of those houses for him. Even in his royal chambers, he was always restless.
The pain felt by all of you, I felt myself, in my own heart, through sleepless nights. I felt agonizing worry about what needs to be done in order to make the lives of the people at least somewhat easier and better.
Yeltsin explained that his early retirement was the appropriate move from a political standpoint. He didn't see the point in delaying the inevitable.
Clinging to power for another 6 months, when we already have a strong person who is worthy of becoming president.
Yeltsin's opponents had a simpler explanation. This tactic would give Putin a huge advantage over other candidates. Indeed, the acting president assumed the highest position almost automatically. As for constant talks about his love for power and his innate inability to relinquish it, Yeltsin claimed all of that to be lies. Even if this was some sort of Byzantine deception, well, politicians usually deceive to stay in power, not to leave.
Happy New Year. Happy New Century. My dear people.
For the first time, the charts were topped by some dark humor. They Killed the Negro was that year's number one hit song. Prohibited drummers from Rostov on Don were following the international Latino music trend while mocking the international political trend of political correctness. They actually tried to ban this song with its lyrics that it'd be panned anywhere outside of Russia. It was first aired on April Fool's Day, which implied that it was a joke, but they continued to play it all year after that. And though the main hero was killed in cold blood, like all other Russian stories, this one had a happy ending. And that's it for episode 39 of The Other Day Current Era, where we discussed 1999. No more modern-day events for the history books. Now it'll just be modern-day life. In the words of a popular movie character, that means we're gonna live. Farewell.